Hello, this is the second in the series of videos that I have planned about the theological origins and underpinnings of modern thought. And in the process of doing that, I'm going, of course, to continue my discussion of Michael Allen Gillespie's wonderful and very important book, The Theological Origins of Modernity. And here it is once again. Now, to recap, Gillespie argues that modern thought essentially emerged out of the collapse of the medieval world, and that the foundations and origins of modern thought lie in a movement among a group of Christian theologians known as nominalism. Now, in the late medieval world, various things were happening which essentially created a ton of chaos. So you had, for example, the failure of the Crusades in the 13th century and the increasing difficulty of sustaining the Crusader states. You had the Little Ice Age and the economic devastation that it wrought on the agrarian economies of Western Europe. You had the Black Death and the horrible havoc that it wrought and all of the people that died as a result of it. You had there also concomitant with the failure of the Crusades, you had the rise of Islam once again as a military and political force, and therefore as a threat to the survival and stability of Western Christendom. And this led to a climate in which a view of the world which was very much unlike the old realist philosophy of the scholastic theologians, could be accepted. So the scholastics had a very rational, very ordered and organized picture of the world. They saw nature as a reflection of the divine mind, as ordered by Aristotelian categories and causes, and therefore as reflecting divine reason, and finally as comprehensible by humans because of this. Nominalism utterly rejected this, and nominalism grew in favor mainly because of the suspicion that many Christian theologians had about the influence of Islam on Christian philosophizing. Remember that Aristotle had been introduced to Western Europe by contact with Islam, and that many Christian theologians had been reading the commentaries of Islamic rationalist philosophers and theologians like Averroes, and so Aristotelianism was viewed as being sort of enmeshed together with Averroism. So a skepticism about Islam and a worry about Islam led to a skepticism about Aristotelianism and pagan philosophy in general, and this led to a kind of rebirth in thinking about Christianity in terms of fideism, of simple kind of belief, rather than a sort of reasoned out, complicated theology, and so on. Now, the central tenet of nominalism, the central point of emphasis, was its radical conception of divine omnipotence. This radical conception of divine omnipotence had all sorts of metaphysical implications, the first of them being anti-realism about universals. Unlike the scholastics, who believed that universals were reflections of divine reason and that therefore they were ultimately real, universals of course being things like redness, blueness, height, rectangularity, etc. You could think of them almost in terms of properties or even like Platonic forms. The nominalists rejected this utterly. They did not think that universals had any reality in themselves. They were simply inventions of the human mind, conventions created by humans to make it easier to speak about the world and get on with the business of living and so on. So, and this of course had all sorts of consequences. So for example, if universals were not real, if they did not exist, that implied that nature had to be a radically disordered individuated menagerie of things. You could no longer group things into classes, and each natural object therefore had to be considered as entirely unique, entirely individuated, and entirely its own thing, a purely and totally unique creation of God. Also, the nominalist radical conception of divine omnipotence meant that everything's existence was contingent on God, and if one could not investigate nature through reason, because of how radically individuated it was, if one could not make use of universals to legitimately help one understand the truth about nature, that means that there are no laws of nature in the true sense, and that everything is contingent upon God's will. This then had the consequence that salvation itself became very uncertain. You could not learn anything about God through reason, and so you had to rely on the Bible and revelation. But even the Bible and Revelation could not really be regarded as secure foundations for an understanding of what it is that one had to do in order to be saved, despite the efforts of the nominalists to deny this, because as Occam and other nominalists repeatedly said, God is no man's debtor. He is under no obligation to keep his promises, to act consistently, because God is just pure will. And so the Bible is really just a record of promises that God had made in the past and that he was under no obligation to keep in the future. So anything that the Bible said about what one had to do to attain salvation was not necessarily valid. It could be changed at any moment. God could save the saints and damn the sinners one day and do the opposite the next. So this conception of divine omnipotence and this view of God as just radically and terrifyingly powerful caused a great deal of anxiety in the late medieval world, and the medieval scholastics were really not able to come up with a coherent or cogent response to this line of thought. And so the nominalists had essentially undercut the foundations of medieval philosophy and destroyed medieval thought, and in the wake of the other broader political and economic cases of devastation and chaos, all the turmoil that was going on and so on, this eventually sort of undid the medieval world. And so we can then come to understand modernity and medieval thought as a series of attempts to come to grips with the nominalist God, his radical, terrifying omnipotence, and all the implications that belief in that had. Now, the first of these attempts at a response that I'm going to be talking about is humanism. And in discussing humanism, I'm going to be discussing Francesco Petrarch, the Italian poet. Now, before I go terribly deeply into all that much about what Petrarch believed and exactly how it is that he tried to craft a response to the problem of the nominalist God, certain things about him in broad strokes should be known. So, for example, like the world around him, Petrarch's own life was rather chaotic. He says in one of the autobiographical writings that he had produced, something along the lines of, "For my entire life, from the first moment to this moment, I have spent my life in almost constant travel." That's a paraphrase. It's almost a quote, but not exactly. He says something to that effect. He talks about how, in giving birth to him, his mother experienced tremendously difficult labor and almost died in the process, so that just by way of being born, he had automatically and immediately been introduced to death. There was constant change and strife throughout his life. He lived through the Black Death and so on. So, in enduring and bearing witness to all of these calamities, and in also accepting the nominalist picture of God, which he did, how is it that Petrarch was able to find a rock of certainty for himself, something on which he could rely, a foundation that he could sort of place his trust in and work off of, something to generate some security for himself and for those that he may influence in light of the chaos that's going on both in the broader world and in the seminaries as this picture of a radically omnipotent God became ascended? Well, Petrarch's answer to this ultimately lay in his self. in his own personhood, his own individuality. To put it simply, Petrarch believed that by reviving classical ideals of virtue and the good life, mainly taken from examples of great figures within Rome. He pulled a lot of thought from people like Cicero and Seneca. But by reviving this and sort of integrating it with Christianity in a way that I will describe in a moment, one could create within one's own person, within one's own self, a kind of haven from the broader chaos and storm of the radically individuated world that nominalism had posited. So, a brief description of Petrarch's life. He was born in 1304. His father, like his grandfather, was a Florentine nobleman, but internecine political conflict had caused his father to run off and go into exile in France. Petrarch was born and grew up in a town in France not far from Avignon called Carpentras. At the age of 12, he was sent to the University of Montpellier to study law. He also studied classics, so he came into contact with a lot of classical writers, as I mentioned, Cicero, Seneca, and so on. And then in 1316, he and his brother were both sent to the University of Bologna to continue their studies. In the process of this course of study, he broadened his knowledge of classical writing and became more attached to and more appreciative of the writers of antiquity. And he also, very importantly, as I will go on to discuss later, developed a great admiration for an interest in the writings of St. Augustine, particularly Augustine's Confessions. Augustine, by the way, is someone who I will be mentioning repeatedly throughout this entire series because he's very important in a number of ways to the emergence of modern thought. So, Petrarch and his brother, Gerardo, were studying at the University of Bologna. Now, they had sort and things had sort of been going like this for them, but then in 1326, when Petrarch's father had died, both he and his brother had returned to Avignon, where their father had been living. Now, Avignon, as I mentioned in the previous video, was at this time the center of the papacy. It was where the papacy was located. And also, 1326 happened to be the year during which William of Ockham was called to Avignon to appear before the Pope and answer on charges of heresy. So he defended sort of his nominalism and the assertions that accompanied it, and in the process also defended the Franciscan order, which was his order. Ockham was a Franciscan. So he defended the Franciscan notion that in order to be a true Christian, one must return to a more original and primitive notion of Christianity, one must live a life of asceticism, of self-denial, of poverty, and these beliefs translated into a critique of the church hierarchy, which at the time was very opulent, and so on. So, right as Ockham is testifying before the Pope and defending himself from charges of heresy, Petrarch returns to Avignon in the wake of his father's death. Now, we don't know for sure how well or how closely Petrarch had followed these particular theological debates or how truly familiar he was with nominalism. He does tell us in certain of his autobiographical writings that he had immersed himself in the intellectual life of Avignon at the time, so we can probably make a reasonable supposition that he was familiar on this debate, and that the nominalistic view both of God and also, more importantly, the notion that each thing in creation is radically individuated probably had a great influence on him. But whatever this influence might have been, Then the next year of his life, in 1327, at the age of about 23, the signal and most important event of Petrarch's life had happened. Basically, he'd met a young woman named, and he'd fallen just wildly, passionately, uncontrollably in love with her. Fortunately for him, his affections were not returned, and so his love was unrequited and tragic. And he had spent really the rest of his life, through his poetry and through his other writings, attempting to master and to quell this passion that he had for this woman. A few things need to be said about this. There's been some debate among scholars of Petrarch as to whether this woman, and he called her Laura in his poems, there's been some debate as to whether this woman was even a real person or whether she is a metaphor for something, some kind of literary trope. There are some people, for example, who think that because her name, Laura, sounds a lot like the laurels that Petrarch was crowned with, that she's really a metaphor for fame, and that what Petrarch was really in love with and really wanted was not a woman, but fame. There are some who think that there's Christian symbolism behind this, because supposedly the tree from which the wood of the cross on which Christ was crucified was made of was a laurel tree. There are all sorts of speculations to this effect. So some people don't believe that she was even a real person. However, there are plenty of sort of autobiographical writings, letters, and so on about himself and his life that Petrarch had left behind. And there's no other testimony from anyone else that really contradicts anything that at least considered in broad details, that he had said about this woman. So we can probably safely assume that she was a real person. This is not some sort of trope that this really happened. By the way, I heard once also an interesting speculation. Gillespie doesn't talk about this, but I heard an interesting claim once that Petrarch's Laura was really an ancestor of the Marquis de Sade, which would be quite interesting if that were true. So that was sort of the most important event of his life, and it occupied him in one way or another till his dying day. Now, Laura wound up dying in the Black Plague years later, and despite this, his heart was not stilled. Right, so this was a thing that affected him for the remainder of his life. Now, upon his father's death, Petrarch and his brother each acquired a sizable inheritance. But by 1330, Petrarch had essentially more or less blown through that inheritance. He spent most of it, and so he came to acquire a secretarial role, to work as a secretary in the service of Cardinal Colonna in Avignon. Now, Cardinal Colonna was a very powerful and influential cardinal, and Petrarch was also friends with the Colonna family, so he had that sort of connection. Now, Petrarch really did not do any kind of serious work for Colonna. He didn't really do much in the way of actual secretarial duty. Colonna was more of a patron, really, than an employer. So Petrarch wasn't exactly working too hard. Petrarch essentially spent the time that he had used in Colonna's employment, which lasted until about 1347, so about 17 years. He used that time to travel, to read, to study, to collect books of all sorts. And Colonna essentially very generously funded this sort of life of a kind of gentleman scholar that Petrarch lived. It's quite nice, actually. So he was doing this until about 1347, and by that time he had left Colonna's service, although he had also acquired quite a number of benefices from various places and various offices that gave him an income. And he also received patronage from other famous families throughout Italy. The biggest example of this is probably the Milanese family of known as the Visconti, the Visconti family in Milan, who were sort of Milanese tyrants. They were also patrons of Petrarch. So Petrarch, from that point on, lived in various Italian cities. He had a steady stream of income coming in from his patrons and his benefices. And he was able to live the life of a gentleman scholar, as I said, traveling around, reading, studying, collecting books, contemplating all sorts of things, and having an extremely extensive correspondence with all sorts of people throughout Europe. In fact, by the 1340s, he was already the most famous private man in Europe. Popes had sought him, kings had sought him, everyone wanted Petrarch to come to their court. But the interesting thing was, Petrarch himself greatly valued his own privacy. He intensely and passionately defended his own independence, and he insisted on being able to live apart from courtly affairs and have his own sort of private kind of personal life. So he never really completely agreed to any of these offers. Now, why is it that Petrarch was so attached to his privacy? Well, as I'll explain in a moment, this notion of the private life, of staying away from the affairs of the world, of not involving oneself in these things, were central to Petrarch's developing conception of what the good life was. Now, throughout his time, partially in Colonna's employment, but also later, he produced a series of great and important works, which I'll examine one by one in due course. Now, not all of these were published in his lifetime because Petrarch had this continual obsessive habit of revision. He was kind of a perfectionist, so not all of this was published. But the first of these were the Canzoniere, usually translated into English as the Songbook. And these were a series of lyric poems. And most of these poems had to do with his passionate love for the woman I mentioned, for Laura, and his fighting and struggling with this, and his attempt to control this, to quell this feeling within himself, and then ultimately his failure to do so. His failure to really calm down the restlessness of his own heart and his own spirit. And so at the end of it all, he basically confessed defeat and hoped that his story would serve as a kind of example to others. Now, the funny thing is that although he himself admits that he can't quite quell this passion, he did use his writing and the ability to sort of get this out of his system that this afforded him in a kind of therapeutic way. So that's interesting. He also produced a work which detailed the lives of various figures of Roman antiquity. He called this the Illustrative Lives, and the point of this work was to give people examples of virtuous behavior, of great deeds, and by giving people these historical examples to inspire them to pursue a similar sort of virtue and greatness in their own lives. There is also a book which consisted of a series of three dialogues between himself and Saint Augustine. And these dialogues were deeply introspective, very self-examining. They delved into the depths of Petrarch's own nature and his own psyche. It was this kind of really obsessive, hypercritical self-examination. There was also a work that Petrarch wrote called On the Solitary Life, and this is essentially a work where he praises the private life, the life of the private, I don't quite want to say reclusive, but nevertheless, not involved in public affairs, the kind of life of a person not involved in public affairs. And he praised this as conducive to virtue and important for personal development, and truly as sort of an integral part of what it means to live the good life and to be truly good. And another work was also an epic poem that he composed about Scipio Africanus, the Roman general who defeated Hannibal. And this poem was called Africa. Now I'll be discussing each of these. But another thing to understand is that now Petrarch fundamentally agreed with the nominalists that all things were individuated, and this is where Petrarch's notion of individual uniqueness and selfhood comes from, and it's also where the broader notion of the broader modern notion of the self comes from. This is where we ultimately can be said to derive notions like political individualism. So they all have that sort of patrimony, but from this point made by the nominalists, from their ontological individualism, he began a sort of great focus on the uniqueness of the individual personality and its importance. But as I said, he also viewed classical conceptions of virtue as extremely important. The problem, as Petrarch saw it, was that the modern world, meaning not the modern world, but the world that Petrarch existed in, his world contained institutions which were not conducive to the flourishing of virtue, but rather worked against it. They worked to undermine it. They were poisonous to it, and so he had set for himself the project of trying to work past and undo what he saw as the terrible consequences of the institutions of his day, the church, the states as they existed, monarchies as they existed. He didn't think any of these things were conducive to virtue and the good life, and he sought as a poet to provide examples of this, and thereby to sort of resurrect classical learning, interest in classical literature, and therefore classical Roman notions of virtue and the good life, and eventually, as I'll say later, to integrate these things with Christianity. Now, his problems with the church were as follows. He essentially agreed with the nominalists and the Franciscans that the church as it existed was corrupt, and that the old-style scholastic realism was not really conducive to true virtue. It was overly intellectualized. Averroism in particular, which was again the philosophy deriving from the Muslim philosopher Averroes that influenced the scholastic realists and Thomas Aquinas so greatly. Petrarch saw Averroism as being sort of the ultimate source of this kind of rationalistic corruption and the greatest example of it, and he was scathingly critical of it. And the first thing he was critical of was the emphasis within Averroism and ultimately also scholastic realism upon the intellect. And he criticized them for not paying sufficient attention to the individuation of things, that all things were individuated and unique, that they were separate individual creations of God, because within Averroism and other more rationalistic philosophical outlooks, there was this tendency toward holism, a tendency toward a kind of holistic view subsumed within a kind of rationalism. He rejected this first as utterly heretical, and second as just blind to the realities of life. And the realities of life were that things in life were, in fact, radically individuated, that they were constantly subject to change. He very much agreed with Heraclitus's notion that all things were in constant motion and perpetual change all the time. He didn't believe in this kind of static, rationalistic picture. So he agreed with the nominalists on all of that, but he rejected nominalism as well. He had no patience, for example, for the nominalists' endless squabbling and arguing and bickering about terms. He saw this as just sort of like pointless word games, pointless word games that had no connection to reality, and that really failed to inspire virtue and proper moral behavior in people. Because as these theological debates became more extensive, more abstract, more rarefied, they began to move increasingly farther and farther away from the flesh and blood realities of life, and therefore theology, under the nominalists, because of their squabbling, so Petrarch said, became something that simply could no longer inspire human beings to acts of virtue. So you also see this, for example, when Petrarch writes about Aristotle. He admits that Aristotle had a very profound understanding of virtue. He writes something to the effect that, yes, he tells us what virtue is, and he understands it deeply, in some cases more deeply than many of the Roman writers that he admired, like Seneca or Cicero. Aristotle, Petrarch said, understands virtue deeply, but he does not inspire one to act virtuously. Yes, he does point out that virtue is attained by habituation, by imitation of virtuous people and good men, and by training, but he doesn't actually provide any examples of this himself, and so he utterly fails to inspire one to act virtuously. This was Petrarch's big critique of Aristotle. Now, in fairness to Aristotle, Petrarch almost certainly did not know that the writings of Aristotle that we currently have are not his published writings. They're actually lecture notes that he had sort of jotted down to help him, talk to his students, explain things to his students. And so that explains why it is when you open them up and you start to read them, they're rather boring. They're actually lecture notes. They're not published works. But Petrarch didn't know that. So now, in Petrarch's conception of things, therefore, you could divide the world, or really world history, into four eras, four periods of time. The first two of these were characterized by reason. So the first of these was the era of Platonic metaphysics. It was the time embodied in the old Greek, really even pre-Aristotelian, Platonic notion of the good life and of virtue, and he very much had Socrates in mind when he thought of this kind of thing. And the second era was that characterized by the Roman moralists that he liked, Seneca and Cicero, for example, or also even Virgil, who through his poetry also gave great examples of virtuous and heroic behavior that Petrarch thought should be emulated. So these first two eras were focused on reason. Reason was central to them. It was believed reason was instrumental and very important in discovering what the good and the virtuous life was, and so reason and virtue sort of worked together in these first two eras. The third era, which he characterized as lasting from the incarnation, that is, the birth of Christ, onto about the 5th century. So here we're talking about the period of early Christianity, and then about, the patristic age, the time of the early church fathers, Augustine, Gregory of Nyssa, etc., the period when these people lived. This, he thought, was the age of faith, the period of faith, and virtue at that time was inspired by religious belief and sort of religious faith and fideism, that sort of thing. The fourth era was sort of after that, following the 5th century. And this is the era characterized by the rise of Aristotle, by Aristotle's critiques of Platonism. And so it too, like the first two eras, was characterized by reason. However, unlike those first two eras for Petrarch, this fourth era moved one away from reason, because it led philosophers, and again he has the Averroists and the Scholastics in mind here, to focus interminably on Aristotelian causes and categories when they describe nature, which are ultimately, because remember he agreed with the nominalists, which are ultimately not real things, and so therefore they're distractions from reality, they don't offer any inspiring images of what it is that a virtuous person must be and do, and so therefore they're of no value. Now, knowing this, we can begin an examination of some of Petrarch's works. Now, I had mentioned briefly some things about the canzoniere, the songbook that he wrote. It was a collection of lyric poems from Petrarch in which he talks about his love for Laura and his inability to quell the violence of his passion. Now, throughout his attempts and his struggles, he constantly tries to bring himself to focus on the transience of earthly things, to focus on the idea that nothing in the world is eternal, that all things eventually pass away, and so therefore it is foolish to make some earthly object the object of your affection. Because, as I said, it will eventually pass away, it's not eternal, and this was more important for Petrarch, it deprives you of yourself. It deprives you of your freedom. If you become obsessively in love with someone or something, as he was, you lose yourself. You become enslaved to this passion. You're sort of pulled hither and thither, willy-nilly by it. And he saw this as a very bad thing, you know, working against virtue and so on. And so he struggled mightily to fight it. He said that one must contemplate death. One must contemplate the transience of things. This will then show you why it is foolish to devote your affection to anything earthly. And therefore, it will lead you to the pursuit of virtue and of higher things, which are eternal, which can overcome death, because virtue, he believed, was intimately connected with fame. So a virtuous man, someone who does great things, he acquires fame and so, in a sense, lives on beyond the span of his own life and is therefore able to conquer death. So you have this sort of hierarchy of things within Petrarch's thoughts. So first, passion conquers the human heart. Contemplation of death and the transience of things. So death then conquers passion. And then fame and virtue then conquer death. But time itself will ultimately conquer even virtue. And the reason he believed this is really just it's really just part of the general sort of Renaissance notion of time as ultimately bringing every structure to ruin. That all of the efforts of humankind, no matter how great and no matter how glorious, will all ultimately succumb to the ravages of time. So it's this sort of Renaissance-era belief in fortuna, in fortune, in time, in fate, as well, not really fate, but fortune and time, let's say, as being the ultimate powers of things, and the things that in the face of which all other things ultimately pass away. But the canzoniere, the songbook, began really as his attempt to conquer his own passion and to focus his attention and focus his will on virtue, on higher things, and to try and move it away from, you know, this passionate love that he has for this woman, for Laura. Now, moving on, as I mentioned, he wanted to write his work, the Illustrative Lives, to give people examples of what virtue was, and he wanted to do this because, as I said, he believed that the institutions of his time were corrupt. He agreed with Aristotle that one becomes virtuous through habituation and imitation of virtuous men. However, the problem for Petrarch's world, as he saw it, was that there were too few virtuous men to imitate, and that the institutions of his time were all corrupt. Therefore, he saw it as his business, as a poet, to construct and create these grand, illustrious examples of virtue, which could then be shown to people and would inspire people, and this would motivate them to pursue the virtuous life. It's essentially his attempt to try and do the sort of thing that Aristotle, he thought, failed to do. So that was the purpose of his Illustrative Lives. Now, he never finished this work. And the reason that he never finished this work is that as he was writing it, something occurred to him. It occurred to him that you could think of virtue in a number of different ways. For one thing, it seems to be the case that, as they say, great men are not always good men. So you can have, for example, great generals or great politicians who do all sorts of sort of awesome, memorable deeds that cement their place in history. But when you examine the behavior of these people, it's often quite Machiavellian and quite immoral, and you know, really just quite bad, quite evil from a conventional perspective. You know, politicians will have to lie, they may have to kill in some cases, they wage war unjustly, and this all happens to be the case despite the fact that they achieve great fame and great preeminence in the eyes of the multitude. And so it occurred to him that it may not necessarily be enough to simply write biographies of great figures within Roman antiquity because of this problem that greatness and goodness do not always intersect. That virtue, living the good life, was not always the same as living the great life of you know, sort of public existence, of being a politician or being politically influential and so on. And this realization brought him to turn to Christianity. Now, there are some scholars who believe that Petrarch's turn to Christianity came as a result of his brother Gerardo's decision to go into and become part of a Carthusian monastery in 1343. And this was rather surprising because Gerardo lived this kind of dissolute life. He threw his money left and right. He lived this degenerate life, basically, and then one morning just woke up and decided to become a monk. So some people think that Petrarch's decision to focus on Christianity was affected by his brother's decision. There's really no direct evidence of this, however. It's more likely that this turn to Christianity by Petrarch came as a result of the realization that I just talked about, that the good man, that the great man is not always the good man, that there are things about attaining virtue and greatness within public life, within the life of the state, that make it so that one who is regarded as great by the multitude is not necessarily a good man. Now, this sort of led him to turn to Christianity. Now, it's funny because in composing his illustrative lives, he had also, in the midst of that project, paused and decided, well, why don't I write an epic poem and try to give sort of the perfect vision of what a virtuous man was. This is where the poem that I mentioned about Scipio Africanus, Africa, came from. Now, Petrarch Scipio is, he's absolutely perfect. He's flawless. He's almost like a Randian hero. Tall, muscular, handsome, barrel-chested, a fierce enemy, sweet as honey to his friends. However, he is virtuous, pious, respectful. He is skillful in battle. He, you know, prays to the gods. He's enormously skilled at everything he does, and he lives this great and dramatic active life, but at the same time he appreciates beauty and justice, and he uses his solitude wisely. He is contemplative. So you have in Petrarch Scipio this figure that finds a way to combine the active life, the life of the politician, the one who goes out and well, it's not necessarily a politician, but often in those days the two things were equated because that was kind of the way that you carved out your own path in the world for the most part. This is a pre-capitalistic age, remember. So that he was one that both lived the active life and achieved great things within the public sphere, but was also a contemplative, reflective, philosophical sort that in his bouts of contemplation achieved great personal virtue. Now the problem with this poem and with Petrarch Scipio is that he's too perfect. He has no flaws. He has nothing to overcome. And so this makes him a sort of uninteresting character. He has nothing to struggle with. Now, also, when we look at Petrarch's Hannibal, the leader of the Carthaginian army and the one whom Scipio defeated, he is utterly evil. He has no redeeming qualities whatsoever. He is faithless, inconstant. He's a backstabber, a liar. He is unable to stand being alone. He can't deal with these things. So he's just horrific in every way. So you have this perfect figure in Petrarch Scipio that's placed on a pedestal, and this horrific, utterly terrible monster in Hannibal. So you have these sort of tropes, and it doesn't make for very interesting drama. Petrarch therefore abandoned this project as well. As I said, he never finished it. And once you combine this again with his realization that great men are not always good men, that just because you achieve great things in the public sphere does not mean that you're a good person inwardly, necessarily, this began to turn him to Christianity. And now we come to Petrarch's work, My Secret. Now, Petrarch had studied Augustine's Confessions quite deeply. St. Augustine, of course, a Catholic saint and theologian and philosopher in the 4th and 5th centuries. And one of his most famous works was the Confessions, in which he had given a sort of spiritual autobiography and deep, introspective, extremely, in some cases often very harshly critical examination of himself. He had sort of confessed himself and spilled his guts out, psychologically speaking, before God in the hope of being forgiven for everything that he had done wrong or had perceived to have done wrong. It was essentially like a series of thanks to God, because as Augustine saw it, neither he nor any other person could be anything without divine grace. The human will was weak and so on. But within Augustine, you had this deep sort of introspective self-examination, one that focused on the self. And this fitted in with Petrarch's notions about individuality and the need for contemplation and self-examination and private study in the formation of virtue. So this work of his, My Secret, consisted of him having a series of three dialogues with Augustine. And it was in many ways similar in style to the Confessions. Just as Augustine confessed to God and addressed the Confessions to God, and by the way, for anyone wondering, here's actually my copy of the Confessions. Just as Augustine addressed that work to God, Petrarch was speaking to Augustine. Alright, now, the first dialogue between them revolves around Augustine's insistence and counseling to Petrarch that he must contemplate death, that he must think about the transience of all things, and this will eventually engender within him a contempt for earthly things. A hatred for, well, not necessarily a hatred, but a lack of an unnecessary admiration or love for the transient things of this earth, because they all pass away. And that, in turn, will turn him to the contemplation of virtue and of God. And since being virtuous is pleasing to God, they sort of, these two things, virtue and piety, sort of intertwine. That to be virtuous is to be pious is to be virtuous in this conception. So Augustine tells him this. He tells him not to focus too much on earthly things, to control his passions, to quell these things. Another thing, he ultimately sort of ends it by giving him a kind of moral counsel that one would see within Stoicism. So, within Stoicism, you have this picture of the philosophic sage who, because of his inner tranquility and inner peace, is unperturbed by the ever-changing, wild, crazy, unstable nature of the world around him, and so he is able to remain at equanimity regardless of what's going on. Augustine sort of gives Petrarch similar advice at the end of this first dialogue. The second dialogue consists of an examination of Petrarch's character in terms of the seven deadly sins. Now, Petrarch is, to his surprise, convicted by Augustine of pride, and, well, the original Latin word for it is acedia, which is often translated as sloth today, but Petrarch didn't use it to mean sloth, he used it to refer to melancholia. So what we today would call depression, just this feeling that you're just sad, you feel like crap, and you don't want to do anything. This is what he thought of as acedius. This is one of the deadly sins that Augustine convicts him of. So he's convicted of pride. He's convicted of pride, greed, and then acedia or melancholy or depression. He's also convicted of lust. And that part doesn't surprise him because, again, of that constant inner struggle that bothered him for the rest of his life about Laura, that he just couldn't let go of, even after she died in the Black Death. So the other sins he's acquitted of. But in terms of these, he's sort of examined and is again counseled by Augustine to sort of let go of his passionate attachment to Laura, but also to glory and to fame and to other transient worldly things, because they're not conducive to virtue. They ultimately work against virtue. They enslave you. They take away your freedom. They prevent you from being your own. They keep you from really working and developing your own personality and individuality to its fullest extent. So Augustine essentially tells him not to do that. And it sort of goes on that way. It's this kind of deep, extremely self-critical examination. Now, the other important thing to realize about Petrarch and his turn to Christianity, again, this is going back to this idea that great men are not always good men, and that therefore, in order to truly cultivate virtue in the real sense, one must withdraw from public affairs. One must sort of withdraw into the self. This is interesting because it has a lot of parallels with Epicureanism. Now, Petrarch himself was critical of Epicurus because the Epicureans were hedonists. That is, they believed that pleasure is the purpose of life. Petrarch rejected this. He believed that virtue was the purpose of life. So we come to the third dialogue between Petrarch and Augustine. And Augustine essentially tells him that in order to be virtuous, in order to be truly good, one must know oneself. One must conduct a deep examination of one's particularity. And remember, since Petrarch, following the nominalists, rejected the notion of universals, he therefore could not say, as the scholastic realists had said, that man's ethical duties consisted in fulfilling his nature. That is, man would discover his essence and his nature as the rational animal standing atop creation. And from that followed all of his natural duties and ends. Petrarch believed that each thing was radically individuated in particular, and because each person was a particular, unique, specific individual with his own personality and his own wants and his own inclinations and his own dispositions, the way to discover the path of virtue for oneself, according to Petrarch, was to learn about oneself, to deeply examine oneself. So Augustine counsels Petrarch again to deeper self-examination, because only when one learns what one truly is can one really learn what it is that one must do. Now, The final work of Petrarch's that really should be given attention here is his work on the solitary life, in praise of the solitary life. So again, building off of this conception that those which achieve great deeds and virtue in public life are not necessarily good men, not necessarily always deeply inwardly virtuous men, a private life becomes necessary for Petrarch in order to achieve true virtue. A private life of a sort of scholar who contemplates his own personhood and his own self and develops his potentialities. Now, I should say that Petrarch did not mean by this that one therefore needed to become some kind of hermit. There are elements of monasticism in this line of thought. By monasticism, I just mean sort of a general view that the world is corrupt and that therefore to be truly good one must withdraw from it. There are elements of that within Petrarch, but Petrarch always allowed within his conception of the private life that the individual retreating into his privacy would always maintain the community and the company of his friends. And he would either, you know, talk to them personally or write letters to them or communicate with them in some way like that. However, this communication, this intercourse would always be voluntary. So it would not be anything like the sort of duties that are imposed upon one when one is within public life. Now this is interesting because Petrarch's notion of individuality and individual uniqueness and how everyone seems to have different ends and wants to pursue different goals and so on. This, obviously, you know, libertarians should say that this reminds one of Austrian economics. It's conceived in very much this way, that people have different ends, that these ends are particular to them, and that they pursue them in the way that they pursue them. But also, what's also interesting in connection to libertarianism here and sort of libertarianism's debt to Petrarch is that notion of the private life, the life that the state, that the public sphere cannot reach, some space that one can go into and sort of leave oneself to oneself and be one's own and only allow in the company of friends and acquaintances and associates on a voluntary basis. So Petrarch seems to have implicit in this the idea of a community that is voluntary, a totally voluntary community based on completely voluntary associations, rather than a community of people that are bound together by politics, as traditionally thought of, bound together by the state, that sort of thing. So, you know, that sounds a lot like anarcho-capitalism. Now, I'm not saying that Petrarch was any kind of anarcho-capitalist, but I'm just saying that the seeds that eventually germinated into that line of thought can be found there. It's there within Petrarch's emphasis on individualism, that whole notion of voluntary community. So libertarians and anarcho-capitalists especially should sort of genuflect to Petrarch and thank him for what he's done to bring their philosophy and their line of thought into being and make it possible. Now, one other reason, and this is moving on, going on with this discussion of the solitary life and why Petrarch thought that it was impossible for one to be truly virtuous without having a private component to one's existence. Petrarch also believed that one who existed exclusively within public life was always sort of attached to or bound to the opinions of the multitude. So if one was always under public supervision, one always had to tailor one's image of oneself to what other people thought of him and make sure that everyone had a good opinion of him. And this, Petrarch thought, was very bad and degenerate because it meant that no one could be truly and authentically himself. He could not be one's own. What he did would always be determined by the thoughts the looks, the kind of social pressure exerted on him by other people. So one could never simply just relax that kind of thing and be oneself. You can see this in politicians today, especially Democratic politicians. They have focus groups that, you know, dictate everything they say. You have political consultants that tell them to say this and not say that. Everything is focus group tested and canned. Nothing seems to be authentic, with the possible exception of one very brash, though not necessarily likable or acceptable or particularly wonderful in terms of policy in all areas, politician that's running for office today. You see that sort of thing where anyone who lives within public life is hemmed in by the beliefs of others, and from here enters a kind of elitist component to Petrarch's thought. He believed that the multitude was essentially sort of mediocre, nothing special, nothing important about them. The true highest heights, the highest peaks of virtue, were probably foreclosed to them. And so anyone who wished to pursue true virtue would have to remove himself into his private study and sort of think and develop and meditate and work on his self. He could read, he could write, he could study, he could have interactions, voluntary interactions with his friends and so on. Another thing that's interesting to point out is that going along with Petrarch's belief that in order to know what it is virtuous for oneself to pursue, one must know oneself. And when one knows oneself, when one learns what one's dispositions are, one can then pursue the good as one understands it. So this is essentially an idea of one can freely pursue the good for oneself once one knows one's inclinations, the inclinations and dispositions that one has had put into oneself by nature. This actually sort of reminds me of the view of free will of a philosopher named Robert Kane. He wrote a wonderful book that I should maybe discuss one of these days, called The Significance of Free Will. And in it, he defends a libertarian notion of free will. Libertarian, not in the political sense, but just libertarian in the sense that free will exists and that it's incompatible with determinism. He defends this notion of free will, and one of the things he tries to do to get around one of the problems for free will libertarianism is to posit something that he calls self-forming actions. So there's a problem within for certain strains of libertarian free will. A lot of libertarians like to define free will as the capacity to do otherwise than one had in fact done or chosen to do. So one is free if one could have done otherwise than one in fact has done in a given situation. But there's a certain objection to this, and this objection is sort of called collectively the Frankfurt cases. And they're these bizarre situations that seem to throw into doubt the notion of the universal validity of this could have done otherwise principle. So, for example, let's say that, some evil alien has implanted a microchip in your brain without your knowledge, and he can push a button and make you do something because of the presence of this chip. So let's say that you're going to vote, and the alien decides that if you freely choose to vote Republican, he's just going to let you vote and not do anything. If you freely choose to vote Democrat, then just before you make the final and irreversible decision to vote Democrat, he's going to push the button, he's going to override your will, and he's going to make it so that you vote Republican. Now, suppose that you chose to vote Republican so that the alien didn't do anything. Now, you couldn't have done otherwise in this situation, because if you had chosen to vote Democrat, the alien would override your will and make you vote Republican. But in this case, you freely chose to vote Republican, so there seems to be a situation in which you freely chose to do something and yet nevertheless could not have done otherwise than you in fact have done. And Cain tries to get around this with his notion of self-forming actions. So he says that the could-have-done-otherwise principle does not have to be universally valid for all situations in all cases for one to be free. All that is required is that one could have done otherwise in cases of self-forming actions. In cases where one is doing something which eventually goes on to form one's character and sort of ossify and create dispositions for oneself. And if one could have done otherwise in those situations, then whatever dispositions that emerge out of that, even if one acts in accordance with them, and even if those dispositions are so strongly ossified that one can't do otherwise than act in accordance with them, then one is still free. Anyway, that's part of Robert Cain's view of free will. That's kind of a tangent, but it does have this connection to Petrarch, because as I said, the humanist emphasis on man and on his will was an eventual spur to more kind of developed and interesting philosophical work on the problem of free will. So in all of this discussion about virtue, now the interesting thing is that despite his turn to Christianity and his references to Augustine, one last thing needs to be said. I don't think that the real life Augustine would have approved of what Petrarch had to say in My Secret, or at least not all of it. The Augustine that he portrays there is more like Seneca than the real Augustine. The real Augustine believed that the will was weak, that humans were essentially nothing and could accomplish nothing and do nothing without divine assistance. So, but in Petrarch you see always this thought that although it may be difficult to master one's passions and direct oneself to the life of virtue, nevertheless it is possible if you try. So there is this kind of Pelagian or semi-Pelagian notion, and remember, Pelagianism is the idea that one could attain salvation without divine assistance simply by way of exerting one's own will. So it's funny that Petrarch is using the person of Augustine to defend this mildly sort of semi-Pelagian view of the human will, when it is because of Augustine himself that Pelagianism eventually came to be considered a heresy within Christian thought. Now, it's not entirely accurate to just label Petrarch a Pelagian. It's a tempered sort of Pelagianism, a tempered sort of emphasis on the human will. He doesn't go full blast on it. He does allow space for divine will, and he does say that certain things are impossible without divine assistance, that one must aim at sort of pleasing God, and so on. So there are these kind of theological elements there as well. He's not a full-blown kind of Promethean. He doesn't emphasize the human will at the expense of anything else, but he does get a foot in the door for it. And that's important. He does get a foot in the door for it. And because he gets a foot in the door for it, this allows those who follow him, the later humanists, to develop other, more expansive, stronger conceptions of the human will that are more Promethean and more extreme. So he sort of sets the stage for that. One final thing to say. When Petrarch speaks of the private life, I mentioned briefly that there's a kind of monastic element to that, that one withdraws from the world because the world is corrupt or insufficiently conducive to virtue, and so in order to attain virtue, one has to step away from public life. Now, I made some sort of brief connections between Petrarch's thought and his emphasis on individuality and libertarianism and anarcho-capitalism. Well, here's another connection. Here, there are a lot of ANCAPs who refuse to vote for moral reasons. They believe that by voting you legitimate the political system, you give your sanction to a corrupt process, and they have this notion of abstaining from it all and retaining a kind of moral purity while doing so. And there are also other libertarian notions, like in Atlas Shrugged. What is Gulch Gulch? It's a place that kind of libertarian-minded people can go to get away from the corruptions, the statism, and the immorality, as they perceive it, of the world. So there's that element of withdrawal from corrupt worldly affairs is also present in libertarian thought. This is not the only example of this. You see this in MGTOW as well, right? You get men who think that female nature is irredeemably corrupt and that women are driven by biological instincts to kind of screw men out of money. Because they think this, men should therefore renounce relationships with women. There's also that sort of Epicurean, almost monastic notion, but it's also combined in MGTOW with the notion that one should develop oneself and one's faculties and live for oneself rather than what they perceive to be, a false idol in women. So there's that kind of connection. Now, in drawing these connections, let me just say as a disclaimer, this doesn't mean that I endorse any of these things. I'm simply attempting to give a genealogy of modern thought. So this is a very long video. It's now easily my longest one. But in conclusion, this is a description of some of Petrarch's thought. He kind of got a foot in the door for Pelagianism and his emphasis on the human will and the human striving toward virtue. Really set the stage for later humanists to develop more Promethean, stronger notions of the human will. And even though you can see elements of, let's say, libertarian thought within Petrarch, sort of mild, kind of basic, really primordial elements of it, even the non-aggression principle in some sense appears, because at one point he says that, each person requires his privacy to develop his individuality, but if each person is to have it, one must also allow everyone else a similar sort of privacy. So if one is doing something within his private sphere that doesn't affect anyone, and he says this in a letter to his brother, then what business is it of anyone else what that person does? So it's not the non-aggression principle precisely stated, precisely articulated. It's nothing like the precise vision of it, that we see in libertarianism today, but the seeds of it are there. And also the seeds of something like MGTOW are there. Now, again, not implying any endorsement of these things, just sort of tracing out an individual genealogy. Now, what I will be discussing in the next video are the people that followed Petrarch, the more Promethean humanists with a much, much stronger, much, much deeper emphasis on the human will, and who are much more obviously Pelagian than Petrarch was. And when I discuss them, and in particular I'll be discussing people like Pico della Mirandola, when I discuss them, I'll also be talking briefly about some of the connections that they have to modern ideologies that seek to overcome the limitations of human nature, that think that through the exertion of human effort one could overcome all sorts of strictures. So we have things like communism, national socialism, fascism, etc., etc. But there's some discussion of Petrarch's thought. This was very long, but I'd hope to create something reasonably complete. And we'll be continuing our discussion of humanism in the next video. So that's all. Thank you for listening.